So I'm Rohit. I come from India. I work with a company called Play Games 24/7. It's a gaming company, and we have a number of social and cash games on our platform. We have a number of users, like our user base is more than 13 million. And with that many users, so basically my talk is actually about client-side A/B implementation. So the way we have implemented A/B around all our products and all our features. So we are very particular about A/B testing, and there's no feature that goes live on our product that is not A/B tested. So that is something that we are very particular. So I'll start with my presentation. So what exactly is A/B testing? So A/B testing is pretty much what Mr. Dilbert is trying to do here. So he is also a very smart guy, and he, in his real life situations also, while taking any decision, he does A/B testing around it. And we should actually try to be like him. But it's actually pretty difficult to be like this in real life, but at least in our professional life, we can do A/B testing around everything. So A/B testing basically lets you test your features, like multiple features, and group your users into different user groups. And same feature, different variants of same feature will be running live on production, and whichever user group is performing well, that is the feature that you want to roll out to everyone. So it actually gives you a very good insight about how your user is behaving, what your user are liking, and what your user are not liking. Yeah, and it helps us make decisions based on user behavior data, and we get an insight how the user feels about a product. The next question, like, why should we do A/B testing? So it's basically because of this guy. So for all those who don't know him, he's Charles Darwin, and he actually said that it's not the strongest and the most intelligent species that survive, it's the species that actually adapts best. That same holds true for our applications and our products. So it's not the best code that you write that will survive most. It is the one, it's a code that can adapt to different, like changing needs of the users. So for that case, we have to structure our application codes in such a way so that any new feature request or any new code change that we are doing, we are able to do it very fast and efficiently. So it basically gives you a better understanding of user behavior, and like, this also gives you avoid rolling out any feature that basically has a feature bias. Like, while rolling out a feature, you feel that it's good. Like, you're working on it, you feel that it will be a major hit, but you cannot be sure because you don't know everything. And once it's on production, then analyzing the user behavior, then you get to know, okay, so this was not good. Like, this feature is not performing as per expectation. Then you have to drop it. So these things, it's very important to structure your code in a way so that when you have to remove a feature, it's easy and it's quick. Yeah. So what I'm going to talk to you about is something, implementation that we have done in our company, and it's a small implementation, but it's super cool. And the kind of advantages that we have seen because of this implementation are really awesome. So let's say I have to implement this UI with a login button with a blue and a green variant. So we can do it in n number of ways, but the kind of approach we have taken is, like, we write our A/B logic into different A/B scripts. So we have a repository that we maintain for writing all the A/B scripts. And all the logic, like, let's say I have to implement a feature, and so this is a script file for that particular feature. So we maintain our A/B params in this JSON files, and there's a function that is written down there. And that function actually takes a predefined input. We have A/B params, we have user params, and we have some sort of historical data on which we decide whether this user has to be put in this A/B group or not. So this logic sits outside our application code. Our application code is not at all aware of what kind of logic is there. So, and this is on a remote server, so we can tweak it anytime. So these A/B scripts are then combined, and we have a CI/CD pipeline that actually merge this code and creates a JSON, remote config JSON, which is pretty much, which looks something like this, yeah. And so all the A/B scripts are compiled, we get a JSON, we host it on a CDN server, and whenever our app launches, the first thing that it does is, like, it just checks whether a new config is there. It'll take that, it'll cache it, and now we are good to go. So, So yeah, so these remote configs also gives us a hold of these functions, so that in runtime and on live production, if we have to tweak any parameter or any feature, if we have to switch off a feature, these functions help a lot, and we can have complex business logic in these so that we can group users based on demography, based on different user groups. After all this, it matters how we are structuring our code, how our application code is actually looking like. So for that also, we one thing that we take care of a lot is that we don't actually write any AB related logic into our application code, because whenever we are rolling out a feature, it's quite possible that that feature might not live long. So, and we don't want to go and change our application code every now and then. So what we do is basically, it's a very small implementation that I've got here. So basically what we do is we maintain experiments components. So all our experiment, like wherever we have to implement a feature where it is into A/B testing, we include that experiment component. And what exactly, what this experiment component does is basically, based on the remote configuration, whatever result we get, like for that particular user, if we have to show him a blue button, it'll spit out a blue button. Otherwise, it'll give you the whatever the other feature is. So this is our SDK client AB. So we include that. We know that this feature is login button. We get the path for this login button, and based on that, we either spit out a green button or a blue button. So that way, and this also, this experiment component also stays outside our main application code. Like we maintain it slightly outside so that whenever we have to switch off a feature, we can directly go and change here. We don't have to go and touch any of the application code. So that way it is safe, and we are able to remove any unused feature or any unused path that is not going live on production after some time. Yeah, so this is pretty much about our implementation. It's a small demonstration I've got here, so, but it's, what we are doing in our company, it's slightly bigger than this. So apart from all these, if you have to discuss anything related to A/B testing, I'll be happy to talk to you after this talk. And if you have any other suggestions that you've got there, how you people are implementing A/B in your company, I'll be happy to discuss that. So what else we have is on our web platform, what we do is basically we have lazy loads based on our, lazy load our code chunks, and we split our code chunks based on A/B parameters so that our code chunks are smaller in size, so that way unnecessary paths are not downloaded by the users. We are also exploring Lambda at the edge for serving our remote config JSON. And one thing that we are very particular about is that whatever AB scripts we write, we need to make it 100% code coverage. Because as Wiseman said, that any unused line of code in your application is basically a bug that is about to happen. So we actually make sure that the AB scripts are 100% code covered. And after the AB is complete, we just remove that old component without any side effect. Yeah, thank you.